such cases of extreme economic vulnerability and community-oriented demands on the state makes the state the most salient player in India's social and economic lives. In fact, an abdication of any of these responsibilities by the state will be considered undemocratic. If, for instance, the state fails to pay enough attention to the developmental needs of a region or a community, a crisis of its legitimacy sets in and grounds get prepared for secessionist or violent anti-state movements, as the armed resistance in the northeastern India and the Maoist insurgency in India's heartland would testify. Finally, we look into the paradox of legal constitutional order in India's democracy. In liberal democratic theory, the constitution is the foundational contract between the citizens and the state. Laws are supposed to protect the sanctity of the contract and the citizens' rights. Any violation is therefore a punishable offense. A collapse of law and order breeds anarchy and threatens democracy. Corruptions do exist in the crevices of the society, but the democratic common sense demands reduction of corruption and establishment of legal procedures. The constitution and the laws, it is assumed, are the ultimate guarantor of the rights to life and property. In Indian democracy, the connection between law and public good is more complicated. I'm not hinting here at the benefits of petty corruption as a facilitator in an overtly rent-seeking economy. Instead, I'm referring to a new literature of Indian democracy that argues that violation of laws can also be morally defendable when it is widely perceived as enhancing the ideals of democracy. These studies draw attention to the margins of the society, where vast majority of the country's population subsists, to the illegally set up shanties on government's lands, hawkers selling their wares on the sidewalks of major metropolitan cities, people stealing electricity from municipal lines, informal workers not buying tickets as they take railway rides to work, auto rickshaw drivers adulterating fuel with pollutant materials to reduce cost and enhance profit. Each of these violations, in some way, undermine the citizens' legal right to the city and public services. Those on the margins of the society, more precisely those outside the fold of the elite civil society of citizens, consider such violation necessary to meet their livelihood demands. So they make a moral claim upon the state, on society, to perpetuate their violative practices. These claims are made not as individuals, but as collectives, so that enough pressure can be created on the administration in addition to a very distinct moral appeal. What is demanded here are not rights that are justiciable in a juridical sense, but a certain form of entitlement that is posed as a compensation for the failure of the state to ensure their livelihood needs. It has also been suggested in this literature that though such demands help deepening democracy, they are not always clean. Rather, the messy world of popular democracy can indeed give rise to dark forces, thoroughly anti-democratic in content, but hugely popular in form. When the reporters visited a village in Rajasthan recently and asked the locals what they make of the court's verdict on the case in which the couple of our fourth story was brutally murdered, they received a very interesting response. The court has done what it regarded as right, but the marriage in any case was unacceptable, as the caste panchayat had claimed. Democracy, as John Donne has famously said, is an unfinished journey. When India, with the world's largest electorate, larger at present than that in North America, Western Europe and Japan combined. Started its journey more than six decades back. An American political scientist had predicted that the journey would come to a grinding halt within few years. It didn't. Rather, democracy has provided Indians with a great learning curve in which the protocols of legal constitutional politics interact with the everyday lives of the communities, producing through innovative popular practices new grammars of politics. India has a great deal to learn from democratic experiences in other countries. The Indian story, I believe, has a good deal of message to offer to the world at large. I think that these malls and McDonald's are catering to this thin layer of civil society. But given India's billion plus population, a thin layer is, you know, comparable to a European country's population. So that's good market, but that's precisely what it is. I mean, there is a catering to this particular section.
What a strange experience I've had has been with Carolyn's. Kerala is a strange place with reasonably good education system. And yet, of course, the largest source of income for the inhabitants appears to be OFW remissions. The people who have to leave India to actually work and make sure they can justify his income in the world economy. That's the inhabitants that you described. Kerala is certainly different from much of what you described up in.
Yeah, actually the state I live in and Kerala, both West Bengal and Kerala, as you know, had this long experience of left-wing governments.
Right.
And although the experiences had been very different, because in Kerala what happened, that the left were part of the Congress in the 1930s, and eventually the left also gained from the anti-upper caste movements, especially among the lower caste population in the state. So education, missionary activities, remittance economy, all this put together has given Kerala a certain kind of edge in public provisioning, which has put the state high up on the human development index. So Kerala, of course, would be quite different than North India, for instance, because most of my examples, as you saw, were driven from India's heartland and North India. So there's a huge difference. I mean, for instance, this kind of caste stories, you know, you won't find from Bengal. This kind of caste stories, you would never find from Kerala. So these are typically North Indian caste stories. So you're right. I mean, Kerala is very different. And India, I mean, you know, to talk about India is so difficult because it's a continental proportion and different regions, different states have completely different political cultures. I mean, in some way, they don't even relate to each other. So it's a very difficult game. But at the same time, I suppose that I tried to bring some of the main streams of India's democratic debate in this paper. Yes, Jim.
So, you know, I was thinking about some of the experiences I saw in Kerala, and thought, wow, what you are saying gives me some understanding that I wasn't getting when I was there. So I remember being absolutely shocked when there was a price raise, and it was in gasoline, and it was a private enterprise, and the price went up, and there were tremendous strikes, and people were demanding the government. Yeah. So in a sense, that sort of communal claim upon the government, as opposed to any notion, or as opposed to this was a private action of raising price. So, yeah, I was thinking as you were talking that there were some things that really resonated with me with respect to Kerala. Carol.
Sure. You are absolutely right. Actually, gasoline price in India is regulated by the government. Even though these are private players which are selling, they cannot actually raise the price at will. There has to be a